Elvis, you were fantastic out there tonight, exclaimed Joe as Elvis bounded off the stage after his electric performance in Honolulu. Beads of sweat glistened on the singer's forehead under the bright lights backstage. Thanks, man. It felt great to be back in front of a live audience again, Elvis grinned, accepting a towel from Charlie to dab his face. Nothing beats that energy and connection with the crowd. As the guys packed up the gear and loaded it into the trucks, Elvis couldn't stop smiling. For a couple hours up on that stage, all his doubts and frustrations with the movies and the Colonel's demands had melted away. Singing his heart out, doing what he was born to do, that's when he felt most alive and true to himself. If only he could capture this feeling and never let it go. But Elvis knew that come morning, it would be back to the Hollywood grind. More insipid scripts and soundtrack songs shoehorned in where they didn't belong. He sighed as he climbed into the back seat of the Cadillac that would ferry him to the hotel for the night. As the Hawaiian coastline whizzed by outside the car window, Elvis let his mind wander. He thought back to that day a few weeks ago when he'd stopped by the state prison after being honored by the Tennessee legislature. Seeing Johnny Bragg still locked up after all these years while Elvis himself had skyrocketed to unimaginable fame and fortune, it put things in perspective. Sure, Elvis had wealth and worldwide adoration, but was he really free? Or was he as much a prisoner as Johnny, just in a gilded cage of the Colonel's design? Flaming star and wild in the country had shown brief glimmers of the serious actor Elvis aspired to be. But Parker kept steering him back to the shallow, assembly line fluff that Elvis found so unfulfilling, so disconnected from who he really was inside. Elvis startled awake as the car reached the hotel, not even realizing he had dozed off. In his groggy state, the high-rise towers and spotlights almost resembled the prison walls and guard towers he'd glimpsed during his visit with Johnny. He shook his head to clear the unsettling image. This posh penthouse suite was a far cry from a jail cell, wasn't it? Sleep proved fitful that night, Elvis's mind too consumed with clashing thoughts and emotions. When dawn finally arrived, he knew what he needed to do. Picking up the phone, he dialed the number he knew by heart. Colonel, it's me. We need to talk. Over the next hour, Elvis poured out his heart to the man who had guided his career for the past 5 years. He spoke of his hunger for more substantive acting roles, his longing to focus on the styles of music that really moved him, his need to break free from the confines of Hollywood before they sucked out his very soul. To Parker's credit, he listened patiently, only interjecting the occasional question or remark. When Elvis finally fell silent, the line cracked with a heavy sigh from the Colonel. I hear you, son. I do, Parker said in an uncharacteristically soft tone. But you have to understand the realities of this business. You're Elvis Presley. Your fans expect a certain image, a certain product. We can't just pull the rug out from under them. With all due respect, Colonel, I think the fans would follow me anywhere I want to go musically, Elvis argued. And I know I've got the chops to pull off some real acting if given the chance. I don't want to be a product. I want to be an artist, expressing my true self. Another long pause from Parker's end. Tell you what, he said at last. Finish out your current movie obligations. Then we'll see about lining up some of these dramatic roles you're hankering for. And I'll talk to the studio about giving you more leeway in the recording booth too. But I'm warning you, Elvis, if it doesn't sell, if the fans don't embrace it, we'll have no choice but to steer this ship back to the tried and true. Understood. Elvis released a breath he didn't realize he'd been holding. It wasn't everything he wanted, but it was something, a chance to start changing course before he smashed against the rocks. Understood. Thank you, Colonel. I won't let you down. As he hung up the phone, Elvis felt a renewed sense of determination thrumming through his veins. He would show the world the true depth and breadth of his talents, prove he was more than just a hip-swiveling heartthrob, and he would make music that stirred people's souls the way those old gospel songs had always stirred his. No more settling. From now on, the artistry would come first. Little could Elvis have known that the Honolulu benefit concert would be his last live show for years to come. In the whirlwind of filming and recording that followed, Parker's promise changes never fully materialized. Oh sure, there were a few films where Elvis flexed his acting muscles a bit more, and he managed to sneak a couple of his beloved gospel and blues tunes onto the soundtrack albums. But by and large, the formula remained stubbornly in place. Still, Elvis carried on, pouring his heart into even the silliest of songs and most trite of movie scenes. If he couldn't change the system, he'd simply rise above it through sheer talent and determination. Let Colonel Parker and the Hollywood bigwigs put whatever label on him they liked. Deep down, Elvis knew his own worth, even if he was the only one who did. But maintaining that sense of self grew harder with each passing year. The adulation of the fans, so intoxicating at first, now felt more like a weight around his neck, a constant pressure to live up to an image that never quite rang true. And the Memphis Mafia, once a source of friendship and support, increasingly seemed like just another set of yes-men kowtowing to his every whim. Only in those rare, stolen moments, alone in his Graceland bedroom with a gospel record on the hi-fi, or in the small hours of the night after the Fairweather friends had gone home, could Elvis reconnect with that scared but hopeful boy who'd walked into Sun Studios all those years ago, daring to believe he had something special to offer the world. As the 1960s drew to a close, Elvis felt more adrift than ever. He needed a lifeline, a chance to rediscover his musical and spiritual roots. And thankfully, that opportunity would soon come in the form of the 68 Comeback Special, a triumphant return to the stage that would remind the world of Elvis Aaron Presley's unparalleled gifts as a live performer. But that's a story for another day. On this warm Hawaiian night, as Elvis gazed out the penthouse windows at the glimmering lights of Honolulu below, he made himself a quiet promise. No matter what the future held, the accolades or the pressures, the artistic compromises or the personal demons to be wrestled, he would never lose sight of the music, the true music, that had set him on this path to begin with. For when Elvis sang from the depths of his soul, he wasn't the king or the teen idol or the movie star or any of the other labels hung on him by others. He was simply a man, broken and imperfect like any other, using his God-given gift to reach out and touch something holy. And Elvis knew with every fiber of his being that as long as he had that music, he would never be lost.